Today we're going to be searching for the western or variable ground snake, which is this snake right here. And it isn't very common in this region. I'm in southern Arizona, but given the right habitat and the right conditions, we should be able to find them. You can see in this area we have manzanitas and oaks, so that's indicative of a high desert that is transitioning into a forest where these guys like to live. Oh, got a little scorpion in here. A very familiar one too. Here is the scorpion in question. This is Superstitionia denensis. One of my all-time favorite scorpions. This one is an adult female, and on top of that, this one is gravid. The way I can tell is this one is almost certainly not going to molt anymore, but its tergites there on the top, the little segments that you see, are spread apart, and the part of the exoskeleton that's between those is called the pleura, and when those are spread apart, it's probably a good indication that you have a gravid scorpion, though oftentimes it just means that they've eaten a lot. Time to put this one back under its rock. Oh, very nice. This is the snake that we're looking for right here. Like many snakes that mature at a small size, this species feeds on invertebrates, and those invertebrates mainly consist of spiders, centipedes, and scorpions. And flipping through rocks out here, I can definitely say that there's a lot of all three of those, especially scorpions. And this snake is generally considered to be nocturnal, but during the day when they're underground moving through the soil, they are probably opportunistic in the sense that they probably go after prey that's living under the same rock as them, or otherwise underground in the soil. And speaking of soil, these do have a preference for a certain kind of soil in the habitats that they live in, since they are fossorial, or spend a great deal of their time underground. And this is true for most species in the genus. During the wetter months, the soil is not very loose, and in this particular area, the substrate doesn't really allow for much burrowing during the wetter seasons, but as it dries and becomes more warm, it nears the consistency of sand. This is the same rock it was under. There's another one underneath, so I think it'll find its way back. Oh, nice. What we have here is a tiger centipede, Scolopendra polymorpha, but it isn't the typical dinky little tiger centipede. This is one of the larger ones that you get at high elevations in Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, and some other areas. And what's slightly different about these is they have longer terminal legs, which are the back ones there. And as you can tell, just like the other ones, these ones are quite docile too. However, if you were to find one active out at night and try to pick it up, there's a much greater chance that you'd be bitten. Look, here I have my tiger centipede. And if I root through here a little bit, there's another Scolopendra, but it's not the same species. This is Scolopendra viridis. There it is. These are very frequently sympatric, or found in the same locations as these tiger centipedes, as well as Scolopendra heros, the giant desert centipede. Oh, nice. Got a Sonoran gopher snake here. And this is just a neonate. So obviously I've done quite a few videos in California, and this species has shown up in several of them, but this subspecies is one that's never been shown on the channel. This is its rock here. I'm not so sure if it'll be able to get back under, but there's other rocks around too. There goes. I found a couple of these harvestmen here, and usually I don't pay much attention to these, but I thought these had some fairly interesting mouth parts, so I'll show you them up close here. These are the pedipalps and chelicerae of this harvestman, and you'll notice that they look a lot like the chelicerae of a scorpion. But if you don't know what those look like, here are the chelicerae of a Paravegevus spinigerus, but you can tell that these are much wider and shorter. And just like with scorpions, these apilions or harvestmen don't have any venom that delivers from their mouth parts, so Since they don't have a tail to sting with, these are completely harmless, and they're just out here feeding on little insects in the ground.
It might get a little too warm under these rocks later today, so I'm just going to release these guys in the shade instead. This one's cleaning its pedipalps. Leave. Oh, nice. Here are a couple of Nian ground snakes.
These banded snakes here are exactly what I was hoping to see. As their name suggests, these snakes are variable in appearance. And technically speaking, you could find a banded and striped variable ground snake under the same rock. As well as being variable within populations, they're also variable across their distribution. For example, in West Texas, you can find the species in all gray, but there's many, many other forms that this snake takes. And actually, before making this video, the only time I'd ever seen the species was in Nevada, and it was a dead one on the road, and that one was banded, just like these ones. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe a banded and a striped snake can come from the same clutch. And speaking of range, the kind of habitat that they occupy throughout their distribution varies quite a bit as well. While this species is known to be quite variable, other species in the same genus can be quite variable as well. And there are a few others in Arizona, but it is the only one found in this particular habitat. Oh, this is kind of interesting. We have a very large Paravagivus spinagyrus there and a Coleonyx, or a banded gecko, under the same rock. And the reason that's strange is we have predator and prey here. This scorpion could easily devour this little lizard here. In fact, if I'm careful here and I put them next to each other, you can see that there isn't a terrible size difference here. And large scorpions in the desert southwest, such as Hedgerus, are known to do two things. One, they do feed on Coleonyx, like this one. And two, they can feed on prey that's around two times their size. So I'm probably going to relocate this little guy. And like most geckos, of course, these have some pretty stunning eyes. Lighting isn't very good though, unfortunately. And at night, those slits will open up into more normal looking pupils, so to speak. I checked this rock here and nothing's living under it, so this guy can have it. We have a southwestern black-headed snake here. This is Tantilla hobart-smithii. And make no mistake, this may look like a baby snake, but it is actually two-thirds of the way to maturity. It's not a very big species at all. I must say, finding this snake was quite a good addition to this video. This is one of the variable ground snake's only direct competitors that is also a snake. This species right here, as well as other ones in the same genus, Tantilla, are known as centipede-eating snakes. And this particular one feeds primarily on Scolopendra centipedes, and is even known to go after the giant desert centipede. And that centipede is found in this area too. And though this is a competing species, you could still technically find it under the same rock as a variable ground snake. They share a lot of the same preferences and habitat. Unlike the variable ground snake, this species does not vary much in appearance throughout its distribution. Going to put the snake back under its stone now. Scorpion right here. And this scorpion is the same species as the last one I showed you. There he is. So as opposed to the last scorpion that we saw, this one is actually a male. It has a greater tail and pedipalp length relative to its body, which is what indicates its sex. As you can tell, this species is quite rotund and glossy, which means it's just missing all the tiny little bumps that a lot of the other scorpion species out here would have on their exoskeleton. And the reason for that is they're highly adapted for burrowing. But that being said, the propensity to make a home out of rocks laying on the ground seems to be kind of independent from their burrowing capabilities, since they rarely have a hole to retreat to under these rocks that they are frequently found under.
Didn't get a video of me turning the stone, but here's another variable ground snake under this little stone. One last thing I want to say about this species is they do have shallow grooves on their rear teeth, which may suggest that they do produce some amount of venom. And if that is the case, it's likely quite akin to that of Diadophis punctatus, which is the ringneck snake, or perhaps the black-headed snake that I showed you. Both of those snakes I just mentioned are known to produce a small amount of venom. And if Sonora semiannulata also produces venom, it's probably not that potent at all. And to my knowledge, there aren't any bite reports from this species. So it seems highly unlikely to be envenomated by the species, let alone bitten in the first place. And if they possess venom, it may very well be prey specific, which means it's much more effective on invertebrates than other reptiles, for example. And with that, I think this is going to be our last snake for the day. As you can tell, the sun is setting. It'll be dark here pretty soon. So I'm going to call it here. I'd say that this was a pretty successful excursion considering that we found two striped and two banded variable ground snakes. So yeah, that'll be all for this video. Thank you for watching.